Greetings everyone, I'm Stefan, and today we'll be talking about the new growth mechanics introduced in Stellaris 3.0 and how you can use them to your maximum benefit in growing your empire much faster than usual. In 3.0, growth is no longer linear on your planets. Instead, it takes the shape of an S-curve. At the beginning, there's a little bit of growth. As the population ramps up, and as long as there's still capacity on the planet, your population growth increases. Later down the line, when the planet reaches its capacity, your pop growth will decrease almost to zero and your planet will stabilize. The way it actually works in game is with increased or decreased base growth on your planets. As you can see on this planet, for example, because we have plenty of population and because we have plenty of planet capacity, we are getting seriously increased growth from our population. Instead of having a base growth of 3, we are getting a base growth of 5.3. And that is a significant difference. You can get up to 6 base growth on your planets, and this will be affected by any modifiers that you have. In addition, you have the introduction of Organic Pop Assembly. Organic Assembly works just in the same way as Assembly did in 2.8. Instead of constructing robots, you instead construct pops. Just like with robots, you can choose what population grows on your planets, and there isn't actually a penalty for choosing to grow one population over another. This pop assembly process is not affected by your current population or planet size. Even if your planet is completely full and normal growth has ceased, you will still be able to assemble pops and potentially resettle them to other planets. One thing to mention, however, is that this pop assembly is mutually exclusive with robotic pop assembly. It is also only obtainable through one of two means. Either you have spawning pools, if you're playing as a hive mind, or you have clone vats if you're playing as an organic. Spawning pools work basically in the same way, you convert food into amenities and extra pop assembly, but clone vats are slightly different. You don't have a job producing assembly, instead the building itself produces assembly. This building, however, is very expensive and requires a lot of monthly upkeep, 2 energy and 30 food. And by the way, this upkeep is not reduced by any modifiers that you might have. You will always have to pay 30 food per month to have the additional plus 3 organic assembly. Now, having 3 organic assembly is significantly better than the robotic 2 assembly, however, this is not impacted by any modifiers the pops might have. Our population, for example, is fertile, however, when we assemble them, it really doesn't matter. This means that even though, yes, you do get a lot more assembly from clone bats than robot plants, robots can increase their pop growth and really the difference is not that significant. Plus, clone bats are locked behind bioascension. And of course, if you go by Ascension, you can't go Synth Ascension, and Synth Ascension is still the number one go-to in 3.0. Now that we know how growth basically is supposed to work, let's talk about how you actually optimize it. First and foremost, having extra assembly is always good. Just like in 2.8, pops are king, and so doing stuff like building robots or building pops is always going to help you out. You also get a lot more building slots in 3.0, and so building up any spawning pools, clone vats, or robotic plants is going to be much easier than before. However, as far as normal growth is concerned, you have to do things a little differently. You always, always have to account for your planetary capacity. The more planetary capacity you have, the bigger the bonus is going to be to growth from population. If we have about as much population as planetary capacity, our population will take forever to grow. If our planetary capacity is double that of our population, we will get extra growth. However, if we have a bunch of planetary capacity open, our pop growth will be massively increased. However, simply increasing your planetary capacity isn't going to make your few pops grow a lot faster. What you will need is a bunch of population on your planet to begin with. Ideally, you want to have 22 pops or more. At 22 pops and 100 planetary capacity, you will max out how much extra growth you're going to get from pops. However, getting to 100 capacity isn't always easy, and you will have to build up a bunch of city districts. It is much easier to instead increase your population slightly and have less planetary capacity requirements to get the maximum growth. For example, if we have 25 pops, we only need 80 planetary capacity to have our maximum growth from population. I found that 25 pops and 80 planetary capacity is the sweet spot for making your pops grow faster. Increasing your population beyond that will only slightly decrease your planetary capacity needs. At 30 pops, you will only need 72 capacity, But that is an additional 5 pops that could be sitting on another planet and maximizing pop growth there. Early on, you ideally want to have 25 pops across your planets, although really late game, you might want to have 40 to be able to upgrade your capital and get all those sweet bonuses from that. When you have 40 pops on your planet, you will still be getting the maximum extra pop growth at 72 planetary capacity. Going significantly beyond that will start eating into your extra growth from pops, and at this point, you will either have to resettle your pops to another planet, either by manual resettlement, or by just letting them be unemployed and automatically resettle, or you can just increase your planetary capacity and have more pops on the planet. However, I still would highly recommend keeping your planets at 40 pops, because ultimately, if you have extra pops on a planet, and you can resettle them on another planet for more growth, it is much more efficient to do that. Now that we have covered how to optimize growth on your planets by having a certain amount of pops and plenty of planetary capacity, let's talk about the slowdown mechanic that will make it so pop growth overall will be reduced as you go later into the game. As you can see, we require 634 growth progress to be able to grow a new pop, and the same thing can be said about assembling new pops. That is because the more population you have, the more growth progress you require to build a new pop. The formula for it is 100 plus your empire population divided by 2. This means that if our empire has 1000 pops, we require 500 extra growth progress, and if you take 500 plus 100, you get 600. This means that we are growing pops 6 times slower than we would be if we had 0 pops. This mechanic is quite severe, and you will start noticing the effects immediately. It applies at the very beginning of the game, and as the game goes on, it becomes harder and harder to grow new pops. In fact, if you try to colonize a habitat or a ring world late game, you will notice that it takes you forever to try to get that planet to get built up, because unless you're resettling pops from other planets, the growth on that ring world or habitat will be significantly slower than it would be if you had no population. This means that late game, just growing population will not be sufficient. You will either have to start invading other empires for their population, buying population on the slave market, or doing some shenanigans, such as, for example, releasing a vassal empire, letting them grow their population, and then integrating the vassal empire, or alternatively, raiding them for pops via nihilistic acquisition. It is a little exploity, and it is a little sweaty. The devs might introduce a mechanic to try to prevent that, because honestly, it makes no sense for you to be able to release an empire, have that empire have low population and therefore high growth, and then just take the pops from that empire. Ultimately, what you're supposed to do is go to war and try to get pops through alternate means rather than just growing them. Before you storm the comments and talk about how stupid this new mechanic is, really, as far as late game performance goes, it is necessary. Reducing pop growth in the late game means that you get reduced pops overall in the galaxy, which means that there's less calculations to do and the game runs significantly faster. Overall, this means that going for maximum growth is quite powerful in the early game because you will be able to get more growth from having a lot of population, but late game it begins to taper off, and I would honestly even say that having rapid breeders or fertile on your late game pops is not that good of an idea. As I alluded to before with Synthetic Ascension, this also means that having more efficient pops is better than just having more pops because you won't be able to really grow a lot of new pops, and even though Bioascension does now have a bit more growth on your average planet than Synth Ascension makes your pops a lot more efficient and thus is the better ascension path overall. When it comes to these new growth mechanics, hive minds have benefited the most and machines have benefited the least. Normal empires, however, have benefited in a few other ways. The old mechanic where you would have to upgrade your capital in order to get your population to grow faster is no longer a thing. Instead, the S-curve mechanic is a thing. If you have less than 10 pops on a planet, the S-curve mechanic will not apply, and so you are still encouraged to have more pops on a planet and not just use them as single pop colony worlds. You can use planets just like this, but considering how you can easily double your pop growth by having enough population, overall, building up all your planets about equally is going to be the way to go. But anyways, that is going to do it for today. If you have any interesting ideas or strategies to do with this mechanic, please do leave them in the comments section, and if you have any questions, I will answer them there as well. With the release of 3.0, I'll be making a lot more videos, and so if you want to support the channel and potentially get early access to those videos, please do consider supporting me on Patreon. Link in the description and in the top right. Anyways, thank you all for watching, and I'll see you guys in the next one. Bye-bye.